My name is James Robinson. I'm an engineer on Google Chrome, and I work primarily on performance. So WebKit is an open source project and a software library that handles many of the functions of a web browser. So it handles, for example, processing HTML, producing a DOM, and providing many of the APIs that web developers use. In itself, it is not a browser, but it's a key component of a browser. And it's used in Google Chrome, in Safari, Mobile Safari, and many other browsers, including most of the mobile web browsers. So WebKit can be thought of as a rendering engine. And this means it handles a specific set of tasks. So one of the tasks it deals with is taking raw HTML and CSS from the web and parsing them into a format that that can then be dealt with programmatically. It also deals with issuing resource loads for all the resources within a page that are needed. And it communicates with the JavaScript engine to ensure that the script on the page runs properly. There's a few major things that the WebKit library does not provide itself. For example, it doesn't provide a networking library or a graphics library. But it does handle the majority of the tasks needed to develop a browser. WebKit, as an open source library, is really a global community. There's contributors all over the world, and they work for many different countries. So it's not unusual to have check-ins happening at 3, 4 in the morning our time, because that might be the middle of the afternoon somewhere else. So you really get to work with a diverse group of people from a different group of backgrounds. It's quite exciting. WebKit's a very important part of Chrome speed. It's integral to displaying web pages and interacting with web apps. A large portion of the amount of time spent loading a page or displaying a page or responding to user action is spent inside WebKit, since it deals directly with the DOM and the interactions between DOM and JavaScript. So we closely monitor the performance of WebKit and the performance of WebKit within Chrome to make sure that things stay fast. So the WebKit project, which existed well before Google got involved, has always been monitoring its performance and ensuring that as new features get added and code gets changed around, that things don't get slower. One of the main ways that this happens is with what are called page load time tests. And what they do is they load a sequence of pages in the browser and then time how long it took for each page to load up and display. And these tests have proven very useful in making sure that as new things get added, things don't get slower. We also have a number of automated tests that are designed to specifically target certain things. So we have a number of tests that deal with interactions between the JavaScript and the DOM, because it's very important in any sort of dynamic web page. And we use this to attempt to detect regressions and ensure that when we do check in optimizations, that they really speed things up. And then the worst form of regression testing is actual users, but it's useful for Chrome since we have the dev channel. So as we push new, maybe slightly untested builds out to users, they will go out, try it on many web pages, and then report back things that got slower. And through that means we can pretty quickly detect that we've broken something and go on and fix it. And ideally, we'll add an automated test to ensure that we don't make that certain action slow anymore. One of the things that we have been working on with WebKit is with interactions between WebKit and the other libraries we have. So one of the main ones is between WebKit and V8, which is the JavaScript engine we use in Google Chrome. Web applications will frequently run some JavaScript code, which then calls into native code. For example, they'll try to update some parts of the DOM or change some styles around. And ensuring that those transitions are very quick is an important part of our speed. So a lot of work has gone into making sure that you can quickly jump from the JavaScript engine to the native code. There's also work that's been done to ensure that you don't end up losing too much time transferring certain data types. Some of the work that we're looking at now has to do with scaling issues. So when WebKit was initially written, the web happened to be somewhat simpler. Pages would be smaller, they'd have fewer images, they'd have fewer text. But as the web develops and developers start pushing it in different directions, things tend to get larger and more complicated. So a web page nowadays might have a DOM that's maybe 10 times as large as the DOM would have been a few years ago. And a lot of the pieces of code that worked fine when things were a little bit simpler are now starting to have some scaling issues. So one of the things we're working on is trying to identify those issues where the initial code just doesn't quite scale well and figure out ways to handle them a little bit more gracefully. One of the other things we're working on to improve performance is to add new APIs that developers can use to make richer web pages that are still very fast. One example will be workers, which let developers use multi-threading techniques, and they allow a web page to do more processing without blocking up the UI. Another one is persistent storage APIs, which let web applications store data on the client side without having to constantly resync everything with the server. And another one that's really exciting is new 3D APIs. So this lets web developers build really exciting, interesting UIs without having to do tons and tons of 3D processing in JavaScript. And a lot of the work for APIs like this happens in the WebKit layer. A lot of these new features are in HTML5. I believe workers are in the HTML5 specification. And there's a number of new APIs that aren't in the particular specification called HTML5, but are in the general category of new APIs. So one of the interesting things about developing a new API for the web is that once you do develop a new API for the web, it tends to get used all over the web. And so one of the challenges when developing these new APIs is ensuring that you develop them in such a way that they'll be interoperable across browsers and that you don't make any mistakes that you'll live to regret later. So when developing these new APIs, there's constant communication with other browser vendors and with application authors to see what sort of APIs they want and how they could be implemented in a way that's efficient both for the implementer and for the applications. One of the areas in WebKit that ends up often being a real performance hotspot, it has to do with dealing with strings. A lot of the resources that you download from the web are in string form. All of your HTML, all of your CSS, all of your JavaScript, and in general, a large part of your data comes down as strings from the web, and then it's handled internally in JavaScript as strings. And typically, these strings will be in different encodings in different stages of the process. So when downloading from the web, it's fairly common to receive UTF-8 encoded strings. But within WebKit, the HTML tokenizer and CSS parser and so forth expect UTF-16 strings. Whereas within the JavaScript engine, strings might be represented as ASCII or UTF-8 or UTF-16, depending on the context. So one of the performance optimizations that we've had to make in several places has been ensuring that we do not re-encode strings when we don't have to. And when we do re-encode strings, we try to optimize for the common cases. So one example has been a string that's in a general encoding, like UTF-8 or UTF-16, will often actually be mostly ASCII, especially if it's JavaScript or CSS. And so if we know that that's the common case, we can optimize for that case and end up encoding the string very quickly if it actually is ASCII. In some cases, we save whether or not the string in a general format really is ASCII or not, because then we can do a very quick string formatting pass. And this has turned out to be a pretty big win on some pages. Another area that ends up being a performance hotspot has to do with repainting. So WebKit, it will internally keep a representation of all of the elements on the page, where they go, and then in what order they should be painted. And then when something changes on the page, say an element moves or some text is deleted, then some of the elements on the page move, and then they have to be repainted so that the user can see the update. So we're careful to only repaint the region of the screen that's needed and ensuring that we don't issue too many repaints. So one of the cases that causes problems was if we issued repaints for many regions of the screen that were overlapping, then that would actually be slower than issuing one repaint for the entire region. So we have some logic to coalesce adjacent paint rectangles. Another issue has been with generating repaint rectangles that are larger than the region of the screen that actually changed. And so we've had to introduce a few checks to make sure that we only issue a repaint for the smallest possible area that could have actually changed. And we have to be careful when doing these that we don't end up underpainting, which means that we failed to repaint a region of the screen that has changed. But when we get this correct, it is actually a big performance improvement.